When creating a responsibility matrix, this is the end result that we want to see. Having purposes, milestones, BIM use cases, the reasons for creating models in the first place. That goes on the horizontal axis. On the vertical axis, we start listing all the requirements, let them be elements, groups of elements, any other kind of deliverables, put into folders or even classification structures. And this creates a matrix in which each and every cell is an information container, which can talk about geometrical requirements, talk about information requirements, responsibilities, shifts of responsibilities, statuses, and so on. The way to read this matrix is, for example, in this case, for 3D coordination, we would need generic and preliminary representation of the elements and load-bearing and material information added to the objects. For cost estimation, we increase the geometry and detail the elements to a proposed reliability and also start adding acoustic rating. At asset information model use case, we would already have an as-built status of the models. Maybe we are dropping some of the information that we had earlier in the execution in the construction phases. But how to get to this with our own set of data? In order to show that, let me jump out from this project and just create a new project and start from scratch. So what I'm going to do now is create a scope from scratch. I'm actually even going to choose the scope module. So I reduce a little bit the noise around and you will see that I only have the scope module here focusing on what I want to achieve. I can build up the set of data from scratch, creating folders. So what if this would be my substructure, for example, and then below that I can start creating foundations, moving in the hierarchy a little bit, and then just add an element, which is going to be my slab on grade, for example. This is one way of doing it. Of course, not necessarily optimal to build it up on the screen. So that's why we will also be able to import from a CSV file. Also, if you are creating such requirements which exist in our library, you can also use the library, and the library will not only give you the predefined types, but will also come with some nice graphics. So for wall foundations, for example, it's a group of elements now. I could either choose individual components and add them to my project, or just click on the add button and add the wall foundations together to my project. Once I have this in the different milestones, in the different use cases that I can create, so maybe this would be a coordination use case, and the other one could be cost estimation. And I can use the recommendation engine and the predefined suggestions as well. So I can start requesting elements as I go, increasing, decreasing the geometrical requirements, and also adding more to it. In order to have information requirements as well, I could use the bottom palette and creating new information requirements here. Talking about existing data sets, you might already have it in an Excel spreadsheet, so that's something that we can import. Let me delete real quick what I created here and show the importing functions. As you can see, I can import a classification structure. I can import the vertical axis and the list of requirements from a CSV file. And that's something that I already created. If you click on the CSV file import, a download on our existing template can be downloaded to format the data in a certain way that can be imported into the application. If I click on my sheet now, this is how it will look like. Having certain pieces of information in a certain order to be able to import it into Planol. If I have it downloaded as a CSV file, the structure is going to be quickly. So I have the shell, the superstructure in my example. If I want to see the coding as well, that's just a view preference setting. So clicking on the classification code, you will start seeing the element. In this breakdown, I can start adding the different requirements using the plus and minus signs. You will see how geometry is requested and being added. Another thing that I want to import is the information requirements. Clicking on the CSV again, I would have access to an example template sheet that I can populate with data to create a CSV file and import. This is how it looks like. Again, predefined set of columns, type of information requirement group, which can be a PSET, name, description, tags, which can be used for quickly assigning information requirements in Planoly. Application will all fall into the right orders in Planoly. So if I import these information requirements, everything is generated on the user interface for me. Using this set of information, I can start assigning information requirements to my elements in the different milestones, which are going to be requested during the modeling phases. I can just go and choose one of the information requirements and assign it manually to one of the elements. So now I assign concrete finish on the coordination for the floor construction elements. But I could also make it a little bit quicker by using the filter option, and that's when the tags are going to be handy. If I filter for, let's say, structural information requirements, now this is the set of information requirements that I want to apply to my structural elements, so I can select all of them. It's a floor construction, and for estimation, maybe I will need these pieces of information. Similarly, I want to apply them on the roof, and on the stairs as well. Spending 1 second on what we see in the information requirements, we talked about the tags already. We talked about the groups, which can be any kind of groups, but we talk about OpenBIM, it would be PSET, name of the information requirements, a description to the information requirements, and then values, what we are expecting, and rules, what we want to apply to these requirements. If I double click on one of these, a list is visible, what kind of information requirements can be requested, starting from any text, text contains or numeric entries, and any values, Boolean, and so on. And so numbers, we can even define values, and of course, units of measurement. Assigning these information in, requirements in the grid results actually the IDS. This is now the human-readable format of the information delivery specification. Very easy to understand what has to be delivered. If we start assigning teams to these requirements as well, then we also see who is responsible for delivering the data. So I'm just assigning these real quick to the ABC team. And then if we want to create the machine-readable format of the IDS, it's just a click from here. So if I go to exporting the files, clicking on the IDS specification, after a little bit of filtering and choosing what kind of which version of the IFC we want to export, which BIM use case we want to export, whether it's the coordination or cost estimation, and how to handle classifications and how to handle groups. So after a little bit of settings, our IDS is going to be created. One more thing going back to the visible grid is using images in our library, in our predefined library. Nice images can be found that will help us communicating human to human and even easier to understand what the requirements are. When using custom elements, images can be uploaded. Clicking on the three dots on the row, multiple images can be uploaded that can also communicate the development of these elements from use case to use case. Custom elements can be populated with custom images as well. This is the way of creating an information delivery specification, the human readable format of it, the machine readable format of it, and also using our own data to create this IDS.